Aang runs into an old friend who puts him through more than a few challenges. This is Avatar Explained for episode 105, The King of Omashu. Part 1, Synopsis. Aang and friends arrive in town. It's a less friendly town than was when they were last here, and they have to sneak Aang in by assuming a fake name. One of the guards is a little curious when he sees Momo's ears poking up out of Aang's disguise, but he doesn't say anything, and Aang rides the slide system in the city. Now, the system is originally designed for packages, but Aang used to ride it with his friend Boomy.
They used it as a fun slide.
And Aang does this again with Katara and Sokka, although they are significantly less pleased about it than Boomy was. Eventually, all their sliding around leads to them destroying the wares of a cabbage salesman. This cabbage salesman recurs throughout the series and will become infamous. His cabbages are always getting destroyed, and he's always quite angry about it. In this episode, he's angrier than we see him later on, and he tries to get Aang and his friends killed. One head for each head of cabbages, he says. The king is significantly less irate than the cabbage salesman, but he's also quite a strange fellow, and he puts Aang through a series of challenges after forcing him to reveal his identity as the Avatar. If he completes these challenges, he gets his friends back. If he doesn't, they stay imprisoned in Crystal. So he does complete these challenges, and they're all interesting. They all have twists. They're all unexpected. At the end of all these challenges, Aang expects to get all his friends back, but there is a catch. He has to say the king's name. This frustrates him because he doesn't know the name until he goes back through his memories and thinks about his old friend Boomy, and he realizes that his strange friend, his very creative friend, grew up to be the king. So he says the king's name to him, and Boomy welcomes him back and offers him advice to think like a mad genius, i.e. be very creative and unorthodox, in order to defeat the Fire Nation and save the world. Overall, it's a good, strong episode, if not as powerful and poignant and layered as some of the best entries in the series. Part 2, Analysis. Again, I wouldn't exactly call this my favorite episode of the show, but it is very interestingly constructed. It's a very sharp, very tight episode. This is an episode that could have easily felt lightweight and underwhelming if the writing wasn't as good as it is. All these three challenges are presented well. There's a real element of mystery to them. One doesn't know how Aang is going to solve all these challenges, so when he does, it's a real shot of catharsis. It's truly satisfying. My favorite is probably the second one, where Aang has to recover Boomy's pet, Flopsy, and he sees a small rabbit and chases it, assuming that's Flopsy. But this rabbit always stays one step ahead, and eventually Aang and the rabbit are chased by this huge hulking beast. Aang initially tries to avoid this beast, but eventually he realizes that this creature is Flopsy, and so he hugs it and welcomes it and calms it down. It's really smart, even though it's subtle. It doesn't seem like a huge accomplishment, but it is. It really is. It's a way to tell a interesting little vignette in a short period of time. Just as a short film, it's quite excellent. Now, I was already won over on Avatar long before I watched this episode. The first episode really hooked me in, and the third episode I decided made me a fan for life. But it's this episode that really made me realize the first time I watched the show just how clever it is, just how well written, just how smart. It is a show that is willing to really take risks and experiment and use unorthodox ideas to really forward its message and its characterization. I do have a few problems, one being that Boomy is portrayed more positively than he really should be. I mean, he may be testing them and he may not have a bad heart, but he did put Katara and Sokka through a lot of pain and suffering, and that can't just be hand-waved away. That is a little dark and macabre, and he really should be criticized a little more for that. It doesn't have to be much, just a line or two would have really helped. The rest of the episode could have stayed the same. My only other big problem with this episode is that there's no Zuko. As I hope you know by now, Zuko's storylines are fantastic. There's a lot of depth and immediacy to his character, even though all the nuances aren't as filled in as they will be later. So that's unfortunate, but as a whole, the episode is really cohesive, really concise, really smart. As a standalone, more fun episode, it's better than it really should be, as are a lot of these less intensive Avatar episodes. I don't call them filler episodes because they're not. They do a good job of advancing characterization and theme, this forwarding all these ideas that become very important later on. So yeah, this is Avatar for you. Even the not quite as powerful and impactful episodes are still really good and really exciting. And I was genuinely surprised when I learned the king was Aang's old friend, Bumi. I really shouldn't have been. Flashbacks make it pretty clear, but on my first watch, I was not aware. Also, and this is a credit to not only this episode, but really every great suspense episode, they work even when you know what's happened. They hold up. It's not the surprise that's the point. The surprise is fun, and if you don't know what's going to happen, it can be a nice jolt. But it's the craft, and it's how they work to create the suspense and the thrill and the drama that's really what's exciting. And that's what you pay more attention to on your second and third watches. This is why I think watching this show, or really any great show, for a second or third, or in my case, seventh or eighth time, is ultimately more satisfying and enjoyable than watching it for the first time. Especially when you can watch the show build and slowly construct its pieces like this show does.
The first five episodes of this show are great, but it only gets better from here. I can't wait to cover everything from this point onward.
Part 3, Context. There's a surprising amount in this episode that comes back later. Of course, Bumi comes back later. We see him a couple more times. In Return to Omashu, they expect him to be there leading the resistance, but he's not. And instead, he's practicing neutral Jing, as in lying in wait and stalling for a great moment to make his move. And when that comes during the solar eclipse, he escapes from his prison and takes back Omashu. It's a really exciting scene, and it's done well. It's a real example of earthbending philosophy in action and how effective that can be. However, more effective, at least to me, is this whole idea of thinking like a mad genius, i.e. going outside the expected and looking for a third option, and not accepting the status quo, not accepting anything less. Aang does this a lot throughout the course of the series. I hate it when people say that his defeating the Fire Lord is Deus Ex Machina. It's not. Yes, it is maybe a little contrived that he gets the power he needs just shortly before the final fight, but it is in line with the themes of the series that he takes a third option. Instead of not fighting the Fire Lord or killing the Fire Lord, he takes away the Fire Lord's bending and makes the world better that way. It's a nice way of how the show can subvert expectations while still feeling honest and real and grounded. And this also ties in with Aang's philosophy as an airbender. He's a pacifist, but more than that, he always seeks a way to not go at a problem from a traditional front-on standpoint. Now, this causes him problems during some points of the series, most notably in episode 209, Bitter Work, when Toph teaches him that, yes, there are some problems that have to be faced head-on. There are some problems you can't just dance around. You have to stand your ground and stand true to your beliefs and ideals. And that's a beautiful moment, but as a whole, Aang's strategy of always looking for the unexpected pays him a lot of dividends throughout the series. If there is a core philosophy in Avatar, beyond the whole idea of balance, it's this. It's thinking like a mad genius, as Bumi would say. It's always looking for a third option. It's being presented with a couple choices and deciding no, deciding I can do something different, I can do something better. And that's one of my favorite things about the show, is how it rejects that binary and is so committed to the idea that there are more options than those which are conventionally given to us. Even the silly, misguided ending of The Great Divide is a real example of this. It's an example of rejecting the binary and choosing another option. And we see this again and again throughout the series. So by the time Aang has to fight the Fire Lord at the very end of the series, it's so built up that it doesn't feel contrived, doesn't feel like Deus Ex Machina. So that's really the use of these episodes. They're sneaky, they're stealthy. They look like they're one-offs, they don't look like they're building to anything, but they are. They're building the ideas and themes that will guide the show throughout its entire run. A good show can do that. A great show, and I do reckon that Avatar is a great show, can do that without making it conspicuous. One watching this episode for the first time would never realize that that's what the show is doing, that that's what it's preparing for, but it is indeed preparing for that payoff with Ozai, and then those slighter, subtler payoffs on the way to that final fight. Again, this is a really clever show.
The first five episodes are proof of that.
And it only becomes more clear how creative the showrunners really are as we go along. So thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed this episode of Avatar Explained. Like, comment, subscribe if you haven't already. Donate to my Patreon if you can afford it and you enjoyed what you saw and you want to see more Avatar Explained videos. And overall, thank you all for sticking around. You're great, and I hope you keep watching Avatar for a long time to come. Adios, comrades.